Good morning.
Good morning. I can hear you well.
We hope there's all three of us are here along with Tom, who's helping us with all the technology and that. But welcome. I hope this morning we'll have some nice interaction and some great questions with the group. Certainly, we've got our things to present, but we're here to answer any questions that you might have, and I'll just have Rick introduce himself for a moment.
Hi, I'm Rick Edgman. I'm the director of research at the Shingo Institute. I've been here about a year and a half, so feel free to ask whatever questions you've got.
Gerhard Plennert, Director of Executive Education here at the Shingo Institute. I'm the guy that'll answer your questions about the workshops and the training programs that we have. So, pass it back to Sean.
So let's start out first. I just want to make sure everybody knows where we're coming from, and we've changed logos recently. We became the Institute a few years ago, but we are part of the John M. Huntsman School of Business at Utah State University, and we became the Institute because we wanted to focus some more on research and bring about some of these things that we're now doing to move the model forward. And we thought for doing that, that's really what we needed to do at that point in time. Many may are probably familiar with the Shingo Prize. The Shingo Prize is housed here at the Institute. The Institute gives out the Shingo Prize along with other awards that we'll talk about as we go through the presentation here. So, the easiest way we have to think about it, and that's why we have the tagline below our Shingo Institute logo now, where it's home of the Shingo Prize. So hopefully that clearly defines where we are at and what university that we're a part of. So let's get into talking about the model. I hope everybody's had the chance to download this or receive a copy of the booklet from us, the handbook. We are in the process of redoing the handbook and putting out another edition because we've had several requests to include some things back into it that have been there in the past and maybe been removed for different reasons. But we're working on that. That should be out by our conference date. We'll actually have that available at the conference. And it will also be available at that time to download once again. So if you hadn't had a chance to do that, most of what we'll be talking about today, of course, other than the questions and that, will be in the handbook, except for, of course, some of the detail that we give and some of the in-depth discussion that we have on it. But everything that we do in the Institute right now really is built around this model. We released the model in 2008, and there was a very distinct reason why we released it. As we went to organizations that had challenged or had received the prize, and actually a lot of other organizations outside of that as well, one of the key issues was, how do we sustain this improvement? How do we move forward and keep it going? Because we're always having to redo the program. And many of you may relate to this in organizations that you've worked for, potentially in your own, where you look at, for example, a 5S effort or a problem-solving effort or a Six Sigma effort, whatever the case might be, and it goes well for 2 or 3 months, and then lo and behold, 6 months from then, you're back trying to get it going again and trying to get people focused back on it. Sometimes we rename them. You've heard a lot of people talk about flavor of the month or this type of thing. I can remember working in an organization and a lot of the programs that we had were based on whoever the leadership was that came in, and leadership rotated quite rapidly in one of the organizations that I was in because we were growing so rapidly. So the initiatives didn't stay around long. One of the key things we want you to remember about this model is it is not another program. It's not intended to be. It's not intended to be something that you take this back and now you're implementing the Shingo program. That's not how we want you to think about it. The way we do want you to think about it is that this is a way for us to look at what we're currently doing and how do we now begin to impact the culture of our organization so that we make what we're doing much more robust, that we're building the systems that we need to drive the results that we want, both behaviorally and from a measures perspective. And that's what we looked at when we built this model. You'll know that you'll notice that in the diagram that you're looking at right now, culture stands out front. And that's actually, although subtle, it's really important because through building the proper systems and that, we can actually begin to shift culture in the direction that we want to. And we'll talk about that a little bit more as we get into the model. So one of the things you'll notice in the model up at the top also is the guiding principles. And you'll see these arrows that go back and forth between systems and tools and results and principles. And those are also quite important because as you begin to look at your organization and look at the results that you want to get, we're also very interested in what you are doing to get those results. That's the behavioral component of this, how you're getting those results. Many of us can think of times when we've gotten results that we probably haven't gone around necessarily the right means of building a system to get them because we needed them quickly. And we got short-term results, but they didn't last. The trend didn't keep up with what we needed to do. And we talk about that from a behavioral sense of what are the behaviors that we need our systems driving? Or in this case, you'll see how it says that systems drive principles, right? Drive the guiding principles. Well, principles are manifest in behaviors. So the model talks deeply about each one of the principles, but they manifest themselves in this model in behaviors. So when we look at systems, we want systems aligned to the principles in the sense of what behavior are they driving. Sometimes they drive good behaviors, and sometimes they drive behaviors that we don't want them to. So we're always working at how do we eliminate the behaviors that we don't want and expound on those behaviors that we do want. So systems are extremely large part of this model because that is what really begins to drive the results and the behaviors. And of course, tools are a part of this system. Many of us are familiar with the tools of operational excellence, and they do get us the results. We want to make sure with this model that they get you the results over the long term and that they're sustainable within your culture.
I could answer one of those questions if you like. They wanted an example, and I have an example that I think is absolutely classic on how systems drive behaviors and undesirable behaviors. What we traditionally like to do is if there's a problem of some kind, what we like to do is build a control system around that problem to make sure that it doesn't happen again. And so what we end up doing is taking our system and implementing a bunch of control systems within that system to try to effectively eliminate the incorrect behavior through that control system. And the example that I want to give you that just real quickly is an example that I ran into in Saudi Arabia. And I like it because it is so classic. The project that we were working on was one of focused on reducing bureaucracy. And this is a purchase order system where the purchase order document had to be signed by 16 individuals in order to pass and be implemented. 16 people had to actually look at the purchase order and sign it. The process took somewhere between 6 to 8 months to do. And so each of these 16 individuals were set up over a period of time as control points because of failures. You know, something went wrong with the purchase order, so they had somebody else sign the document. Well, our process in attempting to reduce the the redundancy in that process, we went to each of those 16 individuals and we asked each of them, what is it that you look at on the PO that makes you say that, okay, it's okay, and I will sign that PO and pass it on to the next guy? And every one of the 16 individuals said that what they look at on the PO is to see if another individual had signed it. And if that person had signed it, then they were sure it was okay, and they would pass it on. So you effectively created 16 control points in a system that had absolutely no control on the actual content of the PO. So there's an example of how we create systems that modify behavior in a totally wrong direction. Anyway, Sean, I'll give it back to you.
Yeah, thanks, Gerhard. Great example there. And keep the questions flowing in, by the way. And Dom will be monitoring those and breaking in every once in a while if we don't happen to see them here. So there was a good example of what happens with some of our systems. Now, every one of our organizations have systems in them. We should be very familiar with tools, systems, and results because we're all trying to drive toward there. The question is, where is our focus? Because if our focus is on results, then we tend to do some things occasionally that have the behaviors in them that are not sustainable, although we may be getting short-term results. So we want to make sure that whatever we're doing behaviorally is getting us those long-term results. So let me go to the next part of the slide here. As we bring in the guiding principles, you notice that these principles are broken into four dimensions, and the model goes into the principles in those dimensions. This is not to indicate that these work mutually exclusive, because they don't. They work all together. They're not isolated from each other. No different than the systems that you use today. They have many behaviors that come out of them that are connected to many different principles. The trick, of course, is isolating those behaviors that are the best indicators of the performance that we're after. So although this is in the shape of a pyramid and looks like it may be linear, it is not linear in the way that it operates and in the way that it's used. Keep that in mind as you go through the principles, because many of the behaviors will be used in multiple principles. A good example of that is problem solving. Well, if we look at problem solving, although that falls underneath continuous improvement, true enough, that's where it's probably appropriate to fall. But even when you're problem solving, a lot of the enablers have to be in place in order that we're driving the correct incentives for people to problem solve. On the other side of that, we also need to make sure that the problems that we're solving are aligned to our corporate initiatives and goals and objectives, so that we are prioritizing those problems appropriately, so that we're driving the correct results for our customers. So again, keep in mind that all of these work together, even though they may look like they sit in a linear type format. They are not. But what the other thing that this drives us to look at is, as you look at cultural enablers, that's the people portion of it.
Got a question, John?
Oh, yeah. Go ahead, Dom.
We got a question from Jeff. I just wanted to ask it before we get too far away from Gerhard's comment. Jeff was wanting to know what was the solution to the 16 signature problem. And also, he wants to know, are principles and behaviors synonymous?
Well, great question. I'll let Gerhard handle the first one on what they did with the the signatures because he was the one involved with that. So,
yeah, the solution is in redefining a system. I mean, one of the oldest principles in lean that tends to be forgotten a lot is that you should always, in the creation of a system, you should always make the right thing easier to do than the wrong thing. And you know what we what this 16 signature business was doing was promoting the wrong thing. So what we basically had to do was to totally redesign the system so that we identified key elements. You know, each of those 16 people were brought in because they were supposed to look at something. Well, what were those somethings? And let's just focus on those key elements and just have one individual that went through it thoroughly and identified and checked those 16 key elements that were being checked. That was a heck of a lot more effective, both in making sure that the POs were correct, but also that the process didn't take 6 to 8 months. You know, it took days instead of months now. So it requires a redesign of the system that changes behavior in the direction that you want it to go. That's basically the solution.
Let me answer the second part of that, Jeff. Principles and behaviors are not synonymous. So the principle tells us for the types of, the more deeply we understand the principle, and let's just pick one for example. If we're talking about flow and pull value, right? The more deeply we understand flow and pull value, then it begins to inform us on what those behaviors are, or what we like to talk about, what those ideal behaviors are. And we'll talk about those just a little bit more in a moment as I bring up the three key insights. But we want to know what those ideal behaviors are, because there's lots of behaviors around flow and pull value, right? Around every one of the principles, there are many, many behaviors. But what are those key behaviors that we want to drive toward? Because if we understand what those key behaviors are, again, informed by our understanding of the principles, then we can begin to build systems that drive us closer and closer toward those ideal behaviors. And if we're driving closer and closer toward those ideal behaviors, as we'll talk about in a moment here, that gets us closer to the results that we want. So in short, no, they are not the same thing, but the principle does inform what those behaviors are, or what those ideal behaviors are that we should be heading towards. So the principle is the one that we begin to build research around. We'll talk a little bit about our online survey that we do, which is called Insight, that begins to give us data so that we can understand more deeply these principles and how they impact the systems in our organizations. But the more deeply we understand that, the better we understand what those key behavioral indicators are, and that drives us toward the result. That's a long answer for a short question, but they are not synonymous. But they are, as I said earlier, they are related to each other, because principles manifest themselves in our organizations in the form of behavior. So when we go in, and one of the things that I oversee at the Institute is the entire assessment process and the challenge for the awards and that. So as we go in and look at organizations, what we're looking at is evidence of behavior and behavior around every one of these principles, because that begins to talk to us about the maturity of the organization as it relates to ideal behavior. And of course, ideal behavior is our standard that we're measuring to. So I'll move on, but if you have more questions on that, we're happy to take them on, because that's a great question, Jeff, and thanks for answering that, or for asking that, sorry. So one last thing as we look at this triangle of guiding principles, where we look at cultural enablers and what we call the four dimensions. You'll notice that one, if we were to group that, and it makes it easier to talk about them, we talk about cultural enablers as the people portion or the people dimension, and processes is the next one when we talk about continuous improvement, and then we talk about purpose, and finally we have the results section or the customer section up on top. So again, not linear, so don't think of them that way. And finally, these are each one of the guiding principles that we put into the dimensions very intentionally as we looked at people, process, purpose, and results. So as you look at each one of these in the model, and as you read on each one of these, I think you'll quickly come to the conclusion that I was talking about earlier on how many of the behaviors in these impact other principles and other dimensions. But it's important to get a very deep understanding of each one of these. And as we go on a little bit further, Gerhard will talk about each one of the courses that we've developed around these. Because at first look, as with most things, that we talk about in lean or operational excellence or however you want to term it, they seem very logical and intuitive in that. But as we actually begin to get down into each one of these principles, they actually become a little bit deeper and a little bit more difficult to implement sometimes than we would think. So we study these deeply in each one of the workshops that we've developed around these. Is there anything you wanted to say about each one of these?
If we're talking about the courses individually later, I'll go into some depth at that time.
So let's get into really the meat of the model, which is the three insights that Dom spoke of earlier when he introduced this webinar. The first insight is ideal results require ideal behavior. And just so you know, these what I've presented so far, it's available for you on the website. You can download it. You can blow up these diagrams and that if you'd like to. So they're already available for you and have been. But ideal results require ideal behavior. So as we move our organizations closer and closer toward those results that we want, which are constantly changing, as we work in continuous improvement, we know we're always moving goals and we're always moving those results to a new bar and moving them higher. In order to achieve those, we've got to have ideal behaviors around that. So let's look at that for a moment. I'm going to just give an example of that. So if we're looking in our organizations to continually get closer and closer toward what customer expectations are, then what are some of the ideal behaviors that we would be looking for in our organizations? Well, as we go into an organization, certainly we would want to see, how do we connect with the customer? How do we understand what the customer really, really wants? Does the customer come in and look at our operation? Do we look at the customer's operation? Do we understand how they use our product or service? Do we deeply understand that enough that we can begin to develop things that the customer hasn't even thought of? Right? How do we do those type of things within our organization? That's just a quick example, but we could do that with each one of these principles. And it doesn't change regardless of the organization that we go into. And that's one very important thing about each one of the principles that we talked about. They don't change over time, and they govern some of the consequences in our organization. So in other words, as you look at each one of those principles, it doesn't matter whether you believe in the principle or you don't believe in the principle. We're all subject to the consequences of following or not following that principle. And by following, we mean building systems that drive us closer toward ideal behavior. If we disregard a principle, we're still subject to the consequences of that principle. And one of the good ones to choose on this, it's a simple example, is flow and pull value. If we don't necessarily pay attention to flow and pull value, or that's not on our radar screen, so to speak, it doesn't mean that we're not subject to the consequences, right? So if all of a sudden we have an influx of orders for a product, but we haven't been able to reduce our lead times, we're still running our operation at full capacity, and all of a sudden we have this influx, well, we can't, there's no way that we can be able to supply what's needed by the demand that just came in. We are always subject to the consequences around the principle. So as you go through each one of those, think of what those might be. That'll help you to think a little bit different about your organization. So ideal results require ideal behavior. So if ideal results require ideal behavior, it's the systems that drive those behaviors. So if we're constantly trying to drive closer and closer toward ideal behavior, we have to understand the ideal behaviors that are informed by those principles. And this is why the courses become so important, because it's drilling down in each one of those principles to what some of those behaviors are and what some of those key behaviors are, because we've got to monitor them. If we're not assessing any of these behaviors within our organization, then our culture is what our culture is, right? And we're not controlling at all what we want that culture to become and the results that we want that culture to drive. We're just letting it happen. But if we're building those systems with the intent of driving it closer and closer toward those ideal behaviors, we are actually now beginning to change and shift that culture to what we want. Sorry, go ahead, Rick.
Well, I was just going to say, Sean is so right on this, on systems drive behaviors. And as a comment, it isn't just that systems drive ideal behaviors. Systems drive bad behaviors. They drive neutral behaviors. They drive good ones, and they drive great ones. And what we're striving for is those great behaviors, or ideal behaviors, as we refer to them.
Absolutely. So so if you think about what Rick just said, that means we constantly have to be monitoring those key systems to make sure that we're eliminating those behaviors we don't want and encouraging those behaviors that we do want, and maybe even adding a few new behaviors, right? You could, as all of you know, working in your organization, I mean, our maturity level in our organization, and sometimes in subsections of our organization, they're all different, right? Part of our job as leaders and managers is to understand where the culture is at in each one of these, so we can move it along at an appropriate pace, because everybody can't move at the same pace, and they're not intended to based on the maturity of their current culture. So think about it this way. When you go into an organization, maybe not your own, maybe an organization you're visiting and benchmarking, right? You come to conclusions about that organization quite rapidly. We all do. And we come to those conclusions usually based on things that we're observing within that organization. Sometimes it's the evidence of behavior, meaning the artifacts. So you look around on the walls, you see the boards, you see the displays that they have, and you begin to make conclusions up in your mind about what's really going on in that organization. Or we would say, what is the culture of that organization? What are the behaviors? Furthermore, you observe what people are doing, how they're talking, the things that they're talking about, what they're discussing in their huddles, what they're pointing at on the boards, what their priorities are. These are the types of things that we look at when we look at systems and the types of behaviors that they're driving. And the great thing about looking at culture is, if you're there long enough and you understand the culture of an organization, it doesn't lie. The culture is what the culture is, The question is, how do we take it from what it is and begin to move things? Because just as I said, a culture is what it is, you can also predict what's going to happen in a culture based on the behaviors that you see. Most of you go into your areas, especially if you're in a manufacturing area, you'll look around at the culture and go, oh, boy, you may look at indicators of near misses or that type of thing and go, geez, it's not long before an accident's going to happen here. And you know that because of the behavior and how you're watching people react to near misses, whether they're just walking by them and discarding them or whether they're taking care of them immediately. In a service organization, it may look different, right? Because accidents may not be the first thing that you're looking at in many service organizations, but you may be looking at, let's take an example of information that's coming into the organization. If organization is coming in, if information is coming in to that organization, for example, for a salesperson, and every time that that information comes in, you see that it's never complete. It never dictates everything that that salesperson needs in order to satisfy the customer, then it's quite easy to predict what customer satisfaction is going to look like and what rework is going to look like. Because that salesperson now has to go out and get the correct information to be able to do their job. So you can begin to predict many things by looking at the systems and at the behaviors that are happening within those systems. So try that as you go back in your organizations, as you walk around and you look at things. I hope that what we're giving you a glimpse of today is to be able to go back and look with a little bit different set of eyes at what you see and what you see every day within your organization, and begin to not only be able to predict some of these things, but also be able to look at, so if I can predict that, how can I now shift that by changing some things within that system?
A quick example on systems that drive behaviors, and this is probably the most obvious and blatant example, is that every one of you listening to this and every one of us are motivated by what we perceive we are measured upon. So what we think the boss is watching us on is what we make look good. And we can make anything look good. Employees can make anything look good. So if you think that your boss is measuring you in one direction, you're going to make that direction look good. That system, that measurement system, is going to drive your behavior, your personal behavior, and how you do your job every day. Systems directly drive those behaviors. That's just a quick example and a real blatant example, but there's many other ways. Another quick one is, I was in an organization where they had quality posters all over the building, but they measured the employees based on number of units produced, and they wondered why quality was so lousy in that organization. Well, you know, you receive what you measure. You measure, you motivate, and that's the behavior that you're going to get. You're going to get parts pumped out whether they're good or not if you're not going to measure quality. Anyway, there's just a couple of quick examples for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, great examples. We have some questions up here, not dissimilar from many that we received from folks that are not necessarily driving these types of initiatives, right? And how do you influence this, and how do you make it sustainable, right? We all have circles of influence of what we can do, and those that we don't influence, but the way we influence leadership is through results, right? That's what leadership is focused on, and we have to deliver those results regardless of what type of organization we're in, whether we're, you know, in a healthcare organization or a service organization, manufacturing, it doesn't matter. We've got to drive results, and leadership does need to be focused on those results. So the best thing that we can do is, how do we, in our part of the organization, in what we influence, develop our systems so that we're driving closer and closer toward ideal behavior? Because as we do, we'll begin to stand out at delivering those results that they're after, that leadership is after, right? That's how we influence leadership, right? We have to get we have to get those results. We have to be focused on those initiatives, right? And we get that through driving the right kind of behavior through the systems that we develop. That's a great question, and it always comes up, right? Because a lot of, and maybe Gerhardt can speak to this a little bit also, and Rick too, because they've been in organizations where, you know, lean initiatives start up, or operational excellence, or Six Sigma, or whatever the initiative is, right? We'd like to think that it's always supported by the top and it always starts at the top, but the reality is that's not how it happens a lot. And it doesn't happen that way a lot because it's these tools and systems that we're developing that help us in the front lines to do our jobs easier and better and faster, right? It helps us deliver those results that are being looked for by management and leadership. That's why they begin to become instilled down on the front line sometimes, driving those operational results that we're looking for. But it's through those results, it's through the attainment of those results, and not only the attainment of those results, but it's the sustained attainment, right? Mm-hmm. It's behavior and the change in the culture. Again, even if it's just a subculture of the larger organization, you begin to be recognized when people go, there's something different about them. They're getting these results. Not only are they getting these results, but they're constantly exceeding these results, and they seem happy about it. They seem happy to do it. They tackle problems. You know, all of these things become those type of ideal behaviors that we're looking at. And I'll give Gerhardt a little bit of time here, as usual. We haven't even gotten through a lot of the slides in the deck here, but go ahead, Gerhardt.
Well, just a quick comment, and this is more or less summarizing what Sean is saying, but a true characteristic of an enterprise that is excellent, an enterprise that's achieving excellence, is to have an environment of sustained continuous improvement. And if you don't have that sustained continuous improvement, if your continuous improvement is a spot event, like a lean event once a year kind of thing, that's not sustainable. That's not changing the culture to where you are a sustained environment of continuous improvement. So that's really what we're trying to drive towards here. We're trying to change the behavior and the culture of the organization to where it gets us into this environment of sustained continuous improvement. That's the difference between what we're trying to do here and what maybe a bunch of lean tools have been doing for you in the past. The lean tools are good. We can't hardly throw them away. You can see them in our diagram there. They're right there on the bottom there. But you can't live without them. But until you get that sustained cultural shift, you know, they're just going to be spot events. And that's the key difference, I think. Go ahead.
Sean, yeah. Would you like to answer a few questions before we go to the...
Without the tools, but what we really cannot live with, or without, rather, is we can't live without results. Literally, we cannot survive without results. And so we are focused on driving results as well.
Sean, I just wanted to know if you wanted to answer a few questions before we get to the third insight, or do you want to do the third insight?
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
Okay, this is one from Richard, and it's quite similar to one from Paula, but the one from I'll ask hers after you answer Richard's. But Richard asks, so he's got a site that has a very robust deviation process already in place, and he wants to know, how do you sell A3 to a site like that so that they can become more effective at problem solving?
Well, Rick is our Six Sigma expert, so we might have Rick begin by addressing that, but let me just say that so it has a very robust deviation process. I'm taking that or assuming that to mean that they have a very good problem solving or potentially a Six Sigma initiative around eliminating deviation. Is that
that's what it sounds like? Yes.
That correctly, and then saying how do we implement include A3 along with that, because I hope I'm taking that right. And of course, each tool is meant for something different. Very good.
No. Yeah, Richard is just saying that you're interpreting that correctly.
Oh, okay. So yeah, so I mean, each tool is used for something differently, and you know, Rick can correct me on this if needed, but you know, Six Sigma is great to use on certain things, but potentially not everything. It may be easier and faster to use an A3 process on other problems that you have. And the other thing about A3 is I believe everybody can learn how to use the A3 process. I don't have to have a statistical or mathematic background like is needed with Six Sigma to understand how to use A3 and to be able to use problem solving. So just by understanding that, that tells me that I can drive problem solving further and further down by using the A3 process where it's appropriate.
Yeah, I mean, I would absolutely agree. So Sean mentioned Six Sigma, and I'm a Six Sigma black belt, but the way that I've used Six Sigma is that it's a way of thinking. And I can think Six Sigma all the time. It's just a very logical problem-solving approach, as are several others. And if I were going to relate to A3, so often A3 is formatted in ways consistent with Plan, Do, Study, Act. And so that is another concrete, logical problem-solving approach. And everybody can do that. Everybody can think and behave that way on a daily basis.
Just a quick thought from my perspective, Gerhard again. You know, the A3 is a project management tool. It's not tied to Six Sigma or Lean or anything else. It's a project management tool. And what you really need to do is do the first couple of steps of the A3 and see what in the heck it is you're trying to solve. And then once you've understood that, then you should be talking about, do you use Six Sigma or do you use Lean or do you use something else, you know, theory of constraints or something else. You know, there's a lot of different kinds of tools out there. Mm-hmm. But that A3 is the tool that manages the project, not the one that decides, you know, not dependent upon. It's the other way around. Anyways, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's great. That's great. Dom, I'm just going to go to the third one here, and then if we have some questions, we can pick up, only because, as usual, I've talked too much already.
That sounds great.
Finally, and this is an easy one because we've talked about it a lot, principles inform ideal behavior. So the deeper we understand the principle, and I've already talked this, so I won't go into it much deeper, but the better we understand what the ideal behaviors are, the better we understand how to develop those systems and encourage the correct behavior and discourage the behaviors that we don't want. So I think as you take each one of these back and really look at you know, some of your operations, I'm hoping that you look through a different lens. And of course, please download the model. Look forward to our new model. It's not a new model, but it's a new description, I guess, on the model is a better way to put it, a more detailed description coming out here at the end of April. And let's take another question just before we move on. What question do you have, Dom?
Let's ask this one from Paula. She's a frontline nurse, and she says, I've witnessed a variety of initiatives that haven't been sustained. Journey to Zero, High Reliability has recently been announced as our strategic goal. Do you have any advice or insight how a frontline nurse can infuse this model to impact success for our HRO?
Yeah, so I guess I can start out, and then Rick and Gerhard can add, and I'll try to make it short because Tom keeps looking at me telling me to cut the time. So if I were to look at this, Paula, by what you're saying, it's to infuse the model means to me, how do I look toward driving ideal behavior? One, the first thing is I got to understand what that is. Toward those results that I want. So if you look up at the model here, you see that principles drive results. And they do that through the behaviors that are informed by those principles. So I would first want to understand what principles are in play with what you're trying to do with the systems that you're trying to develop, because that will tell me the kinds of behaviors that I want to embed in people. And then I've got to begin to select the tools that I'm going to use Remember when we say tools, right? Tools are not only the tools of operational excellence, right? Tools could be a form, a checklist. They can be a lot of different things, right? So, so that begins to inform me of what tools I need to enable the system to drive those appropriate behaviors. So those are some of the things that you need to look at as you begin to instill that, because only by changing those behaviors do you begin to build the sustainability of it, right? Otherwise, as you've said, it becomes an initiative that you're constantly coming back to. Did anybody want to add anything to that? Or?
I think you said it right.
All right, let's move on before Tom kicks me off the system here. So here are the courses that we've developed around each one of those dimensions, as I've talked about. They're pretty self-explanatory here, and I'll have Gerhard just kind of brush on those.
Yeah, just real quickly, this, as we mentioned a little while ago, this is set up as a structure to help drive your organization towards enterprise excellence and toward a sustained environment of continuous improvement. That's what we're trying to get to. You know, just tools by themselves, as you've already heard about 10 times, tools by themselves are not enough. What you need to have is that cultural shift. And this teaches you how to change those behaviors and how to drive towards that cultural shift. Now, the first course, the Discover Excellence course, is just basically an overview course. What are the concepts? What are the principles? What are the insights? And how do they apply to you and your organization? The middle three courses are the dimensions. You know, we saw four dimensions on our model. Cultural enablers was one of the dimensions. Continuous improvement was another. The third course there, the fourth in the series, but the third in that middle bunch, enterprise alignment and results, covers two of the dimensions, just because there's only three principles in total in those two dimensions. The last course then, Build Excellence, is the course that is the capstone and basically ties it all together. And in the end, when you come out of Build Excellence, you actually have a plan for execution and implementation of all of these concepts within your organization. So you learn about it through the first four courses, and then you build a model for execution in the last course. Now, each of the five courses are structured very uniquely. They're all 2-day courses, except for the continuous improvement course, which is a 3-day course. Each of the courses has one day of in-classroom and a second day of on-the-floor Gemba. So what you learn on the first day, you're actually doing on the second day. You're actually executing and doing an example of that on the second day, which is really, really critical and really important, because we don't want to just teach this stuff. We want you to come out of there doing this stuff. You know, those of you that are familiar with Lean know that you don't really get it in Lean until you do it, and that's the same thing here. So you have to have a day of doing it to really get it.
Your heart.
I hope that helps. Now, one thing before I jump to the question is that some of these courses, especially the Discover Excellence course, are going to be offered at the conference, and so that should be a great motivator for you to go to the conference. You can actually take a Discover Excellence, 2-day Discover Excellence course, while you're at the conference as part of the conference. It's a great opportunity, and what you'll get there is a blend of people with a whole different set of experiences, and you'll learn from each other almost more than you'll learn from the teacher. So it's a really good, I'm pitching the conference here, I realize that, but it's for good reason. This is an excellent way to get that Discover Excellence course under your belt and to see how this whole structure works.
Well, and you're networking with people all with the same mindset, you know, all trying to head the same direction.
A good timeline for attending the courses. We don't want you to do the courses all back to back real fast. The reason why is you need some time to think about it. So we recommend basically to do one course maybe at the quickest every month, but more feasibly every 2 months, to a course, just so that you have time to actually take what you've learned in that last course, bring it home, do something with it, and then come back and go on from there. Each course has a lot of testimonials in it from different people with different levels of experience. There's case studies and examples. So what we really try to make these courses very applied so that you can go home to your workplace and make a difference. Sean?
Yeah, and finally, let me just say that these courses are taught by affiliate organizations, and all of our affiliate organizations, you'll see them on the website when you go to attend a workshop or event. All of our affiliates have been trained and licensed to use the course materials and all of that that we develop. So the reason we went to that model was just we wanted to get this out to as many people as possible, and there's no way we could possibly do that with the staff that we have. So it became a scaling issue, and this was a great way to do it with organizations that are like-minded and that are already involved with teaching organizations how to move down their continuous improvement journey. And they're globally distributed, that's true.
So, Sean, we have several questions, but in order to be respectful of everyone's time, we're creeping up on the hour mark, and so I'm wondering if maybe we should move on with Rick's preview of the research track, and then if people want to stick around after the hour, we can answer more questions. That'd be all
yeah,
right.
that sounds good. I think Dom just told us that we are sticking around after the hour, so we're willing to do that, though, and happy to do that, so we will stay around for those that do have questions and that, but again, yeah, we will be respectful of the time. Finally, the reason I bring this up is many folks know the Shingo Prize and what we do with organizations as we go out and assess them. That's the other great thing about the conference. We bring these organizations in so that they can talk about their journeys and talk about what they're doing and talk about, you know, how they're taking the model and beginning to embed these behaviors into their systems and into their structures that they already have in place. I can't emphasize enough that this is not another program. It is a way, though, to strengthen what you currently have and have you begin to look at your organizations differently, especially as you go out and assess them and look at how your systems are performing. Go to the next one, Tom. There we go. And I'll turn the time over now to Rick so he can talk a little bit about some of the research and the research track that we have in store. So,
all right, I'll try and be pretty brief with this, but you know, it's a good things that relate to what's going on in your human resource. Of course, we look for things in terms of innovation and financial performance and environmental performance and so on. So all of those things are critical. And when we talk about excellence, it's a big palette. that we're trying to paint from. So Shingo, the Shingo model, is more or less a way you could describe it would be like this, and I'll do it very briefly. Every enterprise has purpose, mission, and value. Every single one has purpose, mission, and value. Okay, now, some of those values at the global level are things more like anti-corruption and being ecologically responsible and so on. What we have in terms of the Shingo principles, those are the principles that we have out there that are helping to really get things done to achieve that mission, that vision that the organization has. And so every organization, the mission, its vision will inform its strategy and governance, whatever the elements of that strategy and governance may be. You know, you see culture sitting in the background of the Shingo model. It isn't just the background, it is the fabric. A quick and dirty definition of culture is how we do things around here, where the word do is behaviors. So how do we do things around here? And so our strategy tells us what it is we want to do, but we nevertheless have to do it. And so we deploy that strategy. We deploy it through people, through our people, behaviors, through processes, through the partnerships we have, and so on and so forth. And we do that because we are trying to attain results. And the results that we're trying to attain, performance and impacts, if you want to call it that, may be in various areas. It depends on the organization. But we have the strategy, the purpose, mission, vision, values, that those inform your strategy. Strategy is deployed through behaviors effectively, and those lead to performance and impacts. But Sean said this is not a program. We're not looking for a program. And these models, it's not meant to be something that you do once so that you can work toward the prize. Because that prize, or what it takes to get that prize, is really constantly shifting. And so when you're using the Shingo model, what you want to extract from that is it's like going to the doctor. When you go to the doctor, you want them to tell them how you're doing. You want a health report. But you also want that to deliver insight for you as to, or foresight rather, as to how you can become better in the future. And that's exactly what the Shingo model is intended to deliver for you, is not just a health report, how you're doing, but also to guide you toward better results in the future and better approaches in the future. And so the models tend to behave like this, if you look at it from a linear fashion, a linear perspective. All right, we're trying to advance to the next slide. Okay, Tom is going to do that for me. So we have a number of people that are going to be at the conference. These two individuals will be talking to you about total productive maintenance, and they will talk about how to implement, and then they will provide practical implementation approaches, how to implement and applications that they'll show you. One of them is a very active consultant, Tina Agostiotti. And Beth Cudney is one of the young researchers who is highly recognized in the field. She's coming from the Missouri University of Science and Technology. And we have George Easton. George is at Emory University, which happens to be in the Atlanta area. And George is someone I've known for a very, very long time. And he's saying, well, what do Lean Six Sigma projects look like? And he's doing that from the perspective of having been engaged very directly and in depth for a very long time with organizations. He's going to spotlight two Fortune 500 companies and more than 500 Six Sigma projects that they took a look at there. Next. Okay, we'll have Barb Flynn. Barb Flynn is a distinguished researcher, but also a practitioner. She's at Indiana University. She's just had a lot of impact. I'm sorry that I'm going faster here than I would like. But what I can say is that for each of the people that will be presenting in the research track, you can go to the website, shingo.org, and click on the icon for the conference. We have a list of all the speakers. There'll be a biography for each speaker, including Barb and Tina and Beth. And there will also be, if you look in the agenda itself, you'll be able to see a description of what they're going to talk about. So far, a few leading researchers, Shannon Flummerfeld will be coming here from Oakland University in Michigan. Shannon is also what we would call a pracademic in the sense that, yes, she is an academic, but she has vast application experience and experience in industry. She'll be looking at how we thrive in the complexity that we find ourselves in. Sam McPherson is a very experienced consultant who also touches some of the academic end of things at times. And he's going to be looking at basically the brain of the Toyota production system, Obeya. And finally, you've got me, and anything you want to know about me, you can probably find at our website. But in any case, what I'm going to look at is how it is that we make these models really work. So taking them apart, showing a little bit of the theory behind it, but basically how it is we really make them work and drive them through our organization to get to results. So that's what I've got for you. And as Sean indicated, we're happy to stick around and do whatever we can do in terms of addressing your questions.
Yeah, so we're going to stick around here for a little while. Again, thank you. If you can't hold on any longer, we appreciate you being on this webinar. Hope to see you at one of the many events that we do. And please feel free to email us. Our emails are available right off of our website. Or give us a call with other questions that you might have. But we'll stick around here for a little bit and go down here and see what questions we have.
So, so it looks like a few people have had to duck out, but we've still got quite a pretty full room here. So this is a question from Evgeny, and I got to talk with Evgeny in front of a video camera at our European conference last fall in Copenhagen. He brings an international dimension to the discussion. He's saying, is it possible to define the original meaning of the principles in accordance with company or country culture? So in other words, it may mean different things in different these principles may mean different things in organizations within different cultures. So he gives an example of equality, the concept of equality in a hierarchical organization and culture. Can any of you speak a little bit about that?
Hi, Evgeny. Good to hear from you again. I know Evgeny well also. So this is an interesting question. It may mean that we have to work on the definition of what we mean by a principle, but the principle would still hold the same. So let me see if I can put this as succinctly as possible. So, and I know it becomes a little bit more difficult perhaps as we look at respect for the individual and things like that. But let's look at something that because we call these universal principles, right? So which means that they don't change wherever we go to now. I don't mean that in the sense that they may not change in the way we have to define them. We may have to define them, a little bit differently to carry the same intent as we do in English or perhaps in another language, right? But the ideal behaviors are the same. The ideal behaviors don't change, right? So if you're looking at flow and pull, when your product or your service flows, the intent is the same and the behaviors around that are the same. If I want an organization to flow better, then I have to be looking at how I'm going to reduce those lead times, how I'm going to take waste out of the system to be able to reduce those lead times. That doesn't change. Now, how that's interpreted, how we look at that, how we define that may be different, but the same intent is there, I guess. Does that sound right, Rick?
Yep.
Gerhard?
Yep, mm-hmm. You're on track.
I've had the fortunate chance to be to a lot of different organizations in a lot of different places around the world. And although we may have to describe things differently, the behaviors still hold. The principle still holds. So What we do need to look for, though, Evgeny, is the best way to describe it so that the local culture understands it with the intent that we have it. Because by doing so, that also gives us the ability to, again, deeply understand the principle, because that is what informs those behaviors that we're working toward. So it's a great question. And the reason I like that question so much is that most of our applications right now for challengers and that actually come to us internationally from around the world. I would say probably about 70% are outside of the U.S. So it's great. It's a great question.
Great. This is another question. This is from Jason. And he says, would you say that the structure of an organization falls into the systems category?
Well, the first and primary system of any organization is the strategy of that organization. So if you take it from that approach, I guess the answer is yes, but you know, it's not the organization itself, it's the strategy and the way you build around that strategy that is the system, which is the structure of the organization. You got a better way to say that?
Yeah, so I think I'll just say Gerhard's backwards. So based on what Gerhard just said, you would want to build the structure of your organization to support the strategy.
And the strategy is the key primary system that every other system in the organization should be built upon, or should be a subsystem too. Systems aren't independent. Maybe that's question here. Yeah. Systems are interrelated, interlinked, interconnected, and they should be.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, you don't want an organization, this is one of the key things that you find a lot of times, is that organizations are very siloed. And what you don't want is that silo. You want a vertically, horizontally integrated organization. And that requires, you know, sometimes we call it a value stream type organization. And that requires interconnected and interrelated systems between each of what was previously a silo. So.
Yeah, and so if you want that horizontal organization, well, then, of course, that begins to dictate some of the structure of your organization, right? So, yeah, great question.
Go ahead, okay, Dom. Here's one from Chris. How do you get an organization to look objectively at itself?
Oh, boy, this is a really good question. And a difficult one. As you can imagine, what I told you, what my part here is at the organization. So I end up talking to a lot of organizations about feedback and these type of things, because it is difficult, we call that looking at reality, right? And so, of course, our picture of reality is dictated by what we understand about our organization. So you heard me talk briefly about one of the things that we do for research, but this is also something that we provide for organizations so that they can get a glimpse into the reality of their organization. That's when I talked about Insight. Insight is our online assessment tool that is built around, of course, around our model, but it is an internal assessment. So it's how your organization feels about or thinks they are doing as in regards to the principles that we just talked about or we just showed in our model. So doing something like that begins to give you a glimpse of your organization, or what we would call your reality, because culture is the reality, right? Some of us believe and work toward changing and shifting that culture, and some of us feel that the culture just happens however it happens and we're a victim of it, right? Well, this gives you some insight into your organization's culture and where they feel they're going and how they're getting there as it relates to the Shingo model and the Shingo principles. But it is a difficult question, right? Because everybody's reality is formed by their perceptions and by their experience and all of that. So getting everybody on the same page and looking at everything in the same way begins to get us closer and closer toward individuals looking at the same reality.
Yeah, I'm going to give just a little bit different response, because I think that there might be multiple ways that you can get an organization to take a serious look at itself. One of those is the outside looking in sort of approach, where you do bring some a third party in and do a third party assessment of the organization and its performance. So the Shingo model and is from a family of models, if you will, that are self-assessment models, organizational self-assessment models. And they are intended to take regular and rigorous examinations of every important system, function, result, and so on that the organization has. But sometimes you need to have that outside set of eyes so that they're not looking at it with rose-colored glasses or unnecessarily jaded either. So a third-party assessment can be one of those ways to help getting it moving forward too.
And that's exactly, and thanks for bringing that up, Rick, because that's exactly what our examiners do when people challenge for the prize. And that's something that our affiliates do also, as they go in and look at organizations. I think sometimes the more difficult side of that is to have people accept some of the things that are told. So if it's an unbiased assessment of your organization, then you always have to make the choice of whether you see it and how do you see it, and then you have to do the work of digging in and understanding why it is that way. So
yeah, if I were going to use an analogy, I'm not a doctor, and to be honest, I am loath to go to a doctor because I'm afraid of what I'm going to hear sometimes. And that's sort of what the third party is about. I don't know enough to really give a health report on myself. What I know is how I feel. And so I have that self-perception. I go to the doctor so that they can give me a more objective view of how I really am and what I might be able to do to improve myself. And that's to a large degree the intent of having that third party involved.
And I think once somebody seeks that information, that's the first step in being willing to take on some new perspectives in that. Go ahead, Tom.
Well, I was just going to say, Chris had a follow-up question. I wanted to be sure to get to this one because it has to do with Shingo Insight. And his question is a short one. He just asks, how do you measure a behavior like humility? How do you measure when a leader is leading with humility, or a manager? How do you know when they're how can you measure a behavior like that?
You know, it's actually it's a good question, and in that particular case, it's actually easier than you think. I mean, you can walk into an organization, and as examiners, we often do that. You can walk into an organization, and you can almost tell immediately whether this organization has, leadership with humility or not. You see it in the eyes of the individual. If the individuals are excited, if they make eye contact with you, if they want to talk to you and tell you what they're doing, if they're excited about their work, and if this is consistent throughout the organization, well, that tells you that you've got a very different organization than one where the people all look away from you and shy away from you and don't really want to engage with you. You can get that feel right away. I want to add a little bit to what we were saying earlier, and that is really it strengthens the whole idea of this assessment, and that is, what the Shingo process is about finding gaps. We're looking for gaps. And if you don't know where your gaps are between your current behavior and your ideal behavior, then it's really hard to, fill that gap or take care of that gap. So the assessment process tells you where you're at. Your ideals tell you where you want to be. It's that gap that we are focusing on when we talk about the Shingo process. So, you need that. You need that external look. When you look at yourself internally, you'll find out that you miss a lot of opportunities, a lot of things that the outsider, sees, as has been said a couple of times already. But I just wanted to stress this business of the gaps. You're looking for the gaps. Anyway, I'll give it back.
And this is, and this is really important, actually, what Gerhardt was saying. I mean, he prefaced it by saying, well, in this case, it's easy. It's easy if you know what you're looking for. And that's what these courses are designed around teaching you, is what are we looking for? So that if you remember, Gerhardt said on the second day, you go out to an organization. This is what you begin to do. What am I looking for? What do I see? What do I think the gap is in the whatever the organization is that you're using to go out and do the coursework in, right? Because that is what becomes important, is finding that gap. And then for leaders or managers, one of the more difficult parts is now, what's the root cause of that gap? Why do I have that gap? And how do I begin to move that gap? That's the hard work, right? That's the really difficult work sometimes, about, because you have to get down and you have to ask those questions without seeming like you're asking those questions, right? So another example I might give on that is, one time I had an organization call and they said, we'd really like to assess our leadership and how our leadership's doing in regards to some of these things. And I said, okay. I said, well, in order to do that, I'll need to have access to your associates and that. And they said, no, we want to assess our leadership. And I said, well, I understand that. And in order for me to understand your leadership, I need to be able to understand your associates and how they see things and what their reality is. And I think you can catch on to that really quickly, is that's where leadership is manifest. That's where those behaviors are manifest, mm-hmm. is at the associate level. That tells you about what leadership is really doing.
And that's where we measure.
And that's where we measure. That's correct.
Yeah, just a quick comment. It isn't always about what you see. Sometimes it's about what you don't see.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And let me throw out another, just a quick thought here as well. What we really need to, and this is really coming from Shingo himself, Shigeo Shingo, or his son Ritsuo Shingo. If you don't do the Gemba, which is the go and observe, the go and go out there and watch and see what's going on. If you don't do that and don't do it correctly, you won't understand your current state at all. And part of what the whole Shingo process and the courses emphasize is learning how to do that go and observe, that Gemba walk. So it's just a key piece of it, and I wanted to bring it out. Go ahead.
I had a really good friend who was involved in the first benchmarking activities at Hewlett-Packard decades ago. And when he went on his first visits, and their benchmarking teams went out, and they visited a Japanese partner that they had developed, they went around in their benchmarking tours and they walked away feeling but they didn't know what to do with what they had seen, because they didn't really know how to do a benchmarking visit. And their Japanese partner, in fact, said that would be their experience, or was not surprised that that was experience. So part of the experience of going through these five courses and doing the go and see or go to the Gemba, going to the companies and taking a look, is learning how to see. And that is a skill that takes some time to develop, and it really helps to have somebody who's skilled in teaching you how to go and see.
And just another real quick, that made me think of something, you know, everything triggers something else here, but that made me think of a real quick story that when Numi was just starting up, General Motors managers and Japanese managers were working together, and there was a Japanese manager that came for a visit to the Numi plant, and he was walking around the plant with the General Motors manager, and he asked the General Motors manager, well, how's the plant running? Do you have any problems that you're working on? And the General Motors manager says, no, everything is running really great here. And from his perspective, it was. And the Toyota manager looks at him and shakes his finger at him and says, no problem is problem. Mm-hmm. In other words, mm-hmm. the job of a manager is to have that continuous improvement perspective. And he wasn't working on any improvement, so he wasn't doing his job. So anyway, funny story.